Hi.
Yeah, Devapriya has managed to get that caller mic, functional.
On finally. So, Rohit, when we were hearing you, we were really rueing the fact that we didn't have your currency when we were traveling. Because when we traveled around India, we set for ourselves the...
No, but in a way, see, that was something that we decided, right?
Yeah. So, 500 rupees a day. We decided that we would chuck everything, our lives as we knew it, and travel around India on a very, very tight budget. 500 rupees a day for both of us, for bed and board.
All right. See, let's just read a part of the book to make you, you know, give you a feel of why and wherefore did this whole thing begin. So,
it's a small reading, don't worry. In many parts of the world, there is something called a gap year. Not so in India. While young people elsewhere contemplate a gap year, amply aided by exchange rates, 18-year-old Indians of certain classes swat madly for entrance exams. It might not be off the mark to say that middle-class Indians truly peak in focus and ambition between the ages of 16 and 18. It's great hormone management too, in a way.
Yeah, but to cut a long story short, we did not come from a tradition of gap years. And now, past our mid-20s, we missed that age group by nearly a decade. We lived yuppie lives in the heart of Delhi. We had decent, soulless jobs. We even had a garret apartment in a lovely neighborhood that would be filled on certain mornings so generously with the sun and the sound of children playing outside that it was easy to decide in favor of householding and consumption.
We were the usual 9-to-6ers, investment makers, mall goers, office trippers, and city slickers. We were life going to cedars.
And that is when we came up with this insane idea.
Everyone thought we were mad to put all our eggs in one basket. The idea of a transformational journey across India on a very, very tight budget. We went ahead anyway.
This book is the story of what happens next, essentially. But it doesn't give the entire story because, as you can see, this is what happened next. This is a map of our trails through India. We did three phases of journeying. One was a phase in January and in the months of January and February 2010, which is that gray line, or it's actually gray, but it's not seeming black. The lines that go through Rajasthan and Gujarat and also to Dharamshala and to Mathura. That is what we lovingly call the pilot, because at that point, we did not have any experience whatsoever of the kind of journeying we were about to undertake. The red line is the longest phase of journeying. That is the one we undertook in the months of May, June and July 2010 at the height of summer. And it was one of the hottest summers ever, apparently. So that's our journey. We went all the way from Delhi to Kanyakumari. We went down the Malabar coast and up the Coromandel coast as well. There is another phase of journeying that is not depicted here because this is a slightly dated map. You would forgive us. That takes place in the Himalayas, in Uttarakhand, Himachal, and in Chandigarh, and in Punjab, when we went up to the Wagha border.
Okay, now, enough about the map.
I'm sorry, I tend to ramble when I look at this map.
So, so for us, it all began, as we said, like this insane idea. We managed to pitch the idea to a publisher, and they thought, well, it could be a book. So we got a minuscule advance out of them. And the grand story that we could tell back home, oh, you know, we are leaving everything, but we are going to write a book. So the rules that we set out for ourselves, the first, of course, the budget that we told you about, 500 rupees for both of us for bed and board. The second rule was slightly more philosophical. He came up with the fact that apparently Buddhist monks used to be cautioned against sleeping under the same tree for more than 3 nights in a row.
Because they would tend to grow roots then.
Because the human mind is such that even the tree, you get attached to the tree and you know it's your tree. So he imposed this punishing schedule on us that we wouldn't stay anywhere more than 3 nights in a row. Of course, I would go to a place.
Imposed is a very strong word, by the way.
Imposed?
It was more consensual than that, okay.
Absolutely not. It was imposed. I would reach a place. Within 5 minutes, I would get so attached to it, I would want to sort of live there. And I would think, oh my God, And this happened everywhere. So there was this constant battle.
The point is that there is method behind the madness. Okay, there is a raison for those rules. One of the key raisons, is like she's already outlined, was that we would not grow roots in any one place, and she grew roots rather easily. The other was that when you have a tight budget of only 500 rupees a day for bed and board, there are no margins whatsoever. You have to look at things from the ground up. You cannot really, you know, you don't have the cushion that money provides otherwise. We just came off a session about money. When you travel like this, then you become acutely aware about the, you know, the power of money.
And to tell you the truth, why we really wanted to do this, you know, other than it being an insane idea, and how in your 20s you always want to, you know, do an insane thing before it's, yeah, too late.
What we are doing now. I mean, it's bad enough for the two of us to write a book together. Now we have been thrown in the midst of this festival of ideas, which is intimidating.
And we also have to have a fight.
Yeah, there is no moderator between us, right? And we are making a presentation about it.
Yeah, we have to make a good example.
Okay, all right.
Okay, so coming back to the idea of why travel the country and why the budget. Both of us had become writers, you know, by then. I was writing a novel, he was writing his serious nonfiction. But as all urban writers, we knew that very soon the limitations, the constraints would catch up with us. We would become the sort of writers who, you know, spoke at festivals and met other writers. And the disconnect between us and the people we were writing about would grow in leaps and bounds. We've, you know, met lots of writers like that. So the idea for us was to push ourselves completely out of our comfort zone. And what better way to do it than take a bus and know that ahead of you there are only these local buses, which are going to take hours and hours to deposit you from one place to another.
So most of the journeying is on buses. There have been only two train rides in the midst of all this. The rest is all local buses. Buses where you find both cattle and the feed for them, you know. So that kind of thing. So, and the other thing is that about this kind of journeying, what it does to you is, it makes you confront your inner demons, because when you go through that long dusk, when there's this bus traipsing through some part of India, some desolate part of India, there's nothing between you and what lies underneath really. So it sort of brings to the fore something that is inside, within. Once you no longer have, you know, the chores that surround you to save you from those. So it makes you confront certain things.
And also there are the twin anxieties. One, of course, the anxiety of money, because you see, we had worked for only a few years, our savings were very small. And other than the anxiety about money is also the anxiety that you've chosen for yourself, the artistic life, and there are no guarantees. You see, you could have done this whole journey and not had a story to tell, a book to write. So we carried the anxiety until the first book was written, and this is only the first book of the trilogy.
That's the whole point. See, about we are talking about money quite a bit here, but you know, I was trained in alchemy, as Rohit would say. So the thing is that
I would, at the
risk of belaboring this point, see, but on a journey like this, well, see, what are the three classic functions of money, right? It's a means of exchange, it's a store of value, and it's also supposed to be a unit of account, which is what we discussed. So the thing is that on a journey like this, the means of exchange are actually stories themselves. You see, people in India, as people everywhere, but perhaps more so here, they do not tend to reveal what they really think too quickly. They try to gauge what you are trying to say, and they try to agree with you. It is only when you sort of open yourself up to them that they start revealing more about themselves. So stories, you know, although we are here gathering stories, we couldn't be too selfish about it. We have to trade stories on a journey like this. So that's one of the things.
That was a fascinating takeaway for us. And the buses, and in many cases, as you know, it's said about India that every 15 kilometers, the water changes, and every 30 kilometers, the language changes ever so slightly. So on these long bus journeys, we used to be surrounded by clouds of different Indian languages, and yet we would connect with our fellow passengers. There would be like he said, the exchange of stories. And Indians are rather generous with stories.
Yeah, provided you are generous with them too.
Yeah. And there were lots of, we were also always looking out for free meals. So that happened too. People would invite us home. So for example, in Barmer, we were standing on top of a sand dune. And the autowala who had taken us on the sand dune, there's nobody else, he says, you know, you should come to my house for dinner. And I say, yes, of course. I tell him, see, score. We've, you know, saved, what, 100 bucks? And he's whispering to me, obviously, you know, on the side, we don't know this guy at all. I'm saying, yeah, well, we'll see. So there was a lot of that too, a lot of these instinctive risks we took to get in search of these stories. That's, of course, the job of the writer.
You're going with instinctive, right?
Yes, okay, of course.
Fine.
Now, the other challenge for us was when we actually got to writing the book. So initially, when we were traveling, there were notes and there were photographs and there was a lot of politics about who took more notes, who didn't take any notes. But eventually, we had like a whole sheaf of notes.
I'm not blind, by the way.
Well, they need to know. Okay. So anyway, so we came back and we had a sheaf of notes and we postponed the act of actually writing the book on and on and on. And you know, the answer to that is because, I don't know if you guys have read the Motorcycle Diaries. It begins with a very interesting observation that the two people who traveled were not the two people who came home. And the two people who wrote the book were not the two people who traveled. And the two people who are talking about the book now are not the two people who wrote the book.
Yes, that is true, although it sounds a bit like...
Very convoluted.
But the thing is that, see, this is a bit like the Motorcycle Diaries without the motorcycle, right? You have a bus instead. Mm-hmm. And the thing is that this it's a very different thing. When you travel, when we were travel, we had this anxiety, you know. Here's the unit of account function of the stories. Will we have enough to write? Because our strategic objective was to actually write something after we had journeyed. So there was this whole question of whether we'll have enough to write.
So between the story and the book, there falls the shadow. There's always that trouble. So we had a lot of material. We had a lot of anecdotes. We had a lot of facts and figures. We had a lot of myths and legends and historical things. Lots and lots of things. But to weave it into a narrative that would honestly recount the journey, tell, honestly reveal things about ourselves, which we, you know, when you're traveling like that, you're not your best selves. So that was, I suppose, an even bigger challenge than subsisting on 500 rupees a day.
It's a difficult proposition. It's a difficult proposition even at the best of times. Here you've traveled, journeyed across. You thought you were anxious about what you'll garner from your journey. Now you find you have a surfeit of material. You really, you know, you have enough grist for your mill, as it were. But putting it all together, envisioning something like this in your head, executing it, and then putting it all together in the form of a book is three different things altogether.
And you know, so we finally understood why they say that when you write something which is like a memoir, you're actually inventing the truth. You're inventing it though it is the truth. And that was quite a sort of difficult lesson to learn. Worse, because we remembered things differently. So we decided to go with two different voices, our voices, which then we edited.
That was an extremely loaded statement on your part, by the way, about inventing the truth. These are all highly contestable words in today's environment. Now, why don't you speak about what you see, what is the key takeaway in terms of, you know, inventing the truth?
So inventing the truth, when I say that, what I mean is that the act of writing itself is a highly artificial one, as any art form is. You would know, as architects, you're artists too. The moment you try to recreate, you know that you're not obviously recreating exactly what happened. It would be impossible and it would be deathly dull. So you are imposing a certain selectivity, a certain shape on the narrative to come up with something which yet tells you exactly what our journey was like. So that is where the struggle was with writing the book. We still have book two to go, so we have to do it all over again.
The journey turned out to be so extensive that it was not possible to put everything down in a single volume.
So it spilled over into...
So what was intended to be one book is now three, with this being only the first installment.
The other main sort of takeaway for us, was that when you write about India in English, what are some of the anxieties that you face? One of the things, for example, that I discovered for myself was my sensitivity to cow dung. I'll give you an example, okay? So, obviously, there's cow dung in a lot of places. And when there was this part in the beginning of the book when I was writing it, and I said, oh, we stepped down from the bus and we stepped squelchingly into cow dung. And then later on, when he was reading that bit, he said, was it really cow dung? I mean, we've had so much cow dung shit clouding our, a lot of talk about India, that when you write in English about India, you also have to have a certain kind of self-awareness about what it means. So, you know, for me, it was like a joke that if I were writing in Bangla or Marathi or Malayalam and you said gober, gober meant gober, because there's a certain purity in using an Indian language when you know that the context will not be misunderstood. However, when you encounter cow dung in Indian writing in English, when you encounter it in the New York Times, they represent two different things. So we had to be a little conscious about that also. So it taught us about writing, learning to write in Indian, which is an Indian English, but it's Indian. So I think that was another
takeaway. I mean, the whole process of writing, where you have to, you know, there's some idea in your head and it hasn't really taken shape, but you are, you know, you're sort of very pleased with it. Very soon you start seeing the, once you get into it, you start seeing the serrations, the sharp edges, all that. It's not so beautiful anymore. Then you start wrestling with it. You try to, and you see, at any point of time, you have to confront the possibility that whatever it is that you so hold dear, that sort of set you on your journey, may not be valid at all. The whole proposition may be invalid. You are confronted with that possibility as well. So, you know,
then when ultimately what you're doing is just some sort of a pinko fad, like urban.
That it's all contrived at the end of the day. That is the other thing. That is the one thing that I think, if you ask me or her as to what it is that we have learned from this kind of endeavor, is that, you know, I am not so certain anymore about many things. It's not so easy to be certain about things. The way discourse sort of goes back and forth nowadays, people have highly polarized opinions, and it's as if they're quite set in what they see, what their perception of reality is. I won't even go that far. Even opinions about certain things.
So one of the things that, you know, these hurtling journeys did, that they sort of, our certainties were left behind in the wind as the bus rumbled on through the country. And, you know, when you talk about Indians in the newspapers, when you immediately you're talking about large masses of people, when you meet their flesh and blood selves and they tell you what they feel about themselves, you see the agency, you see the mix of the good years and the bad years and the good days and the bad days, you learn to be much more uncertain. And I think that's the main takeaway, that as artists, you have to open yourself up to that uncertainty. And it's good that the land teaches you that.
Certainly. And to get out of, you know, certitude, that was one of the ideas behind this undertaking. We did not want the intermediation that, you know, that media provides and things like that. See things for ourselves, however cliched that might be. But that brings us to the other things. With this book, we have also added a layer of intermediation now. The very thing that we sought to apparently, you know, avoid.
Reject and do for ourselves. So for us, really, the success of the book would lie in if, after reading it, you wished to rewrite it. You know, you wish to see for yourself. Not everybody has to travel insanely. It is possible to do it where you are, even by sitting still, but to rewrite it, really. So, but I want to circle back, and I want to, we've introduced too much of grim,
grim note. You've taken the festival to ideas theme a little too seriously.
Yeah, so maybe we'll read a funny bit. We'll go right back to the beginning of the journey when the rules were being enforced. And one of the rules, of course, was that we should travel light. Okay? Now, Look, I'll be honest here. It was my first ever backpacking trip across anywhere, okay?
Mine
even
too.
Across a park. Yeah. So I came up with a very comprehensive list that needed to be packed, okay? So I'm going to tell you what my list was. 3 jeans. One could get wet while the other is dirty, in which case I would thank my stars that I'd packed in a third. Not 9, not 8, not 7, 6 t-shirts. They're very like ordinary cotton t-shirts,
why
very
six?
Light.
Why 6?
A couple of salwar kurtas. We might be travelling through rather conservative places where it might be considered too firang to prance about in jeans. For field work, for people to talk to us freely, we need to be discreet and fit in. One dressy top and one dressy salwar kameez. In case something came up, in my head it read like dinner with a princess or something. We were going to Rajasthan after all. An iron to ensure that all of these were well tended. One of the lightest irons in the market. I had scarred it well. A big bottle of Easy for all the laundry. On a budget trip, that's the first place where one saves money, right? One hand washes one's clothes. Big box of tissues, hand sanitizer, 2 tiffin boxes, one each. Preferably to match the bags, one red, one black. Biscuit, protein bars in case we find ourselves locked up somewhere. A medicine kit plus different kinds of vitamins. A couple of notebooks. Thermals. Light sandwich toaster. Maybe? I had a question mark next to it. A pot of Nutella.
Yeah, okay. I have a sense of deja vu now.
Okay, hang on.
She's gone through the whole list. It seems like we are packing again.
I had only got this far and was wondering which books to take. You can't go on a transformative journey without any books. When S insisted on checking out my list. Not that he offered his list to me, which was a scrunched up napkin with the words, lots of underwear, checkbook, charger on it, scrawled in the corner. He then went on to throw a mighty fit.
That's just her version, by the way. I'll just say something. This book is divided into 2 voices. There is her voice and there is my voice. This is a section, she's reading out from a section where it's her doing the talking.
Yes, and it's my list.
So it's her version of events.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. Will you go on?
No, but you haven't completed that yet.
Okay, so you went on to throw a mighty fit. Apparently, only the hand sanitizer in my entire list could be allowed.
Okay, I remember that a little differently. But
who
still.
Made you boss of the trip? Nobody. I bellowed. This project is my idea.
Yes, it was her idea to begin with, I agree.
But and then he told me the following.
But were you aware that over-preparation could have dangerous consequences too? Did you even know the case of Salomon Andre?
No.
There was this person called Salomon Andre, right? In 1897, he dreamt of reaching the North Pole in a hydrogen balloon. Not just any old hydrogen balloon, but one equipped so exhaustively with such imagination that it would seem that they had planned for every conceivable eventuality. They had the world's first primer stove, enough cutlery for fine dining, a Hasselblad camera, an onboard dark room, even a cooker that could be lit remotely. Except all this did not make any meaningful difference at all. 3 days later, the balloon sank. Barely 200 miles from the starting point, their bare-chewed bodies were discovered 33 years later.
It doesn't prove anything.
No, it does.
Sitting on the floor amid a bunch of clothes in a sunless hotel room in Paharganj, secretly mulling over the possibility of our bare-chewed bodies coming home in gunny sacks, and my mother saying, this is exactly why I said this is a very bad idea. So, I think we've talked enough.
Yeah.
We were hoping you guys would have some questions.
Talking about a book is never easy.
Thank you. If some of our teachers here find their students missing, we know what they are doing.
Well,
they're probably out with we don't longer have 500 rupee notes, so I don't know what they're going to travel with.
Okay.
See, this is the reason why my relatives keep our young cousins well away from us, you know.
Thank you again. This was really fascinating and we hope to read your book. Do we have any questions? Can you? Okay. I'll come here and then come to you.
So 2 questions. How often did you hit the upper limit that was like 500, and how cheap were the cheap days? And second question was, how did you prepare for medical emergencies, right? There could be medical emergencies where you have to...
Okay. So the thing about the upper limit is we had interpreted the whole budget thing a little differently. So I thought that if on a day we managed to like save 100 rupees, then I could spend that 100 rupees on cake, which I really, really sort of craved. And he thought that if you have saved 100 rupees or 200 rupees or whatever, then it gets added on in case of medical emergency. So I don't know, you're probably an alchemist too by training. So there were a lot of differences over that.
See, the thing is that Devapriya had a black budget during the trip, right?
I did not. I wish I did indulge
her fascination for sugar-laden stuff. So she did that. So the actual budget is classified above top secret.
But that's not true.
But the thing is that we averaged out. There are states where you cannot live on 500 rupees a day for two people. There are states where you can live on less. Then there are occasions when people invited us to eat at their home.
Or stay at home.
But there are many days when we just ate two meals a day. That is also true.
Yeah, sometimes even one meal.
Stay close to the budget. Because the imposition, the budgetary imposition was, the fiscal imposition was not, you know, just out of, it was not an oddity or a device. We had left our jobs.
Yeah.
So we were sort of traveling on our meager savings at that point. So we had to scrounge out a bit.
And to confess, when we finally actually, we had to sort of end the journey in Chennai, we were down to 167 rupees. Okay, and you know
between
that...
Between the two of us.
Yeah, and so we had to be evacuated. Tickets had to be bought for us to get home and, you know. And even this book, the first part, it ends with a part where we are holed up in Paharganj in a very cheap room, and he's writing some articles furiously so that, you know, we can get some money to travel further.
And so great was Devapriya's desire to consume something sugary that she did not fall sick throughout the entire trip so that she could use the budget for,
Indeed. Fortunately, I think we were lucky. There were no major...
I did fall sick, by the way, once in Kolhapur. That was a period when...
We had to sort of stay on for a few days. We had found a cheap room. That was not difficult. And I think to save budget, you had homeopathy medicines.
Yeah. So, you know, it works, sort of. Whether you call it a placebo or not, it sort of works. It's cheap and it works.
But for traveling, I would say Kerala and Rajasthan are two states that you can really do it.
In Madhya Pradesh, I actually drank water from a 500-year-old Bundela tank. In Orcha, right? So, and I'm still here. So perhaps, you know.
Yeah, so the first thing we had to give up was like buying water and all that nonsense.
You had to
so,
drink whatever you could.
Yeah.
That's how you had
And
to
often drink. Meals would just be samosas because they were the cheapest. Like.
Or in your case, something else.
Which were very contested. Cake.
There is this whole section about, just a second. There's this whole section about how I had to get her out of Jaisalmer. There's this German bakery in Jaisalmer, right?
And it's right next to the bus stop.
It's right next to the bus stand, and the bus was leaving. And Devapriya was insistent that she wanted to buy a piece of cake from there before she left.
Just pop into the shop for
2 minutes. But the bus was leaving, so I sort of fobbed off this notion that you could get, you know, great cake in Barmaid too.
And Barmaid is like Madna. I don't know if you guys have seen English August or
well,
read the
book. Bought me some 2-3 hours of peace. The next 2-3 days were hell because Barmaid is this sleepy wildcatter town
bordered with
Pakistan. It's seeing a boom right now because oil has been found there. So there's KN Energy, there's Last
Minute Tupro and all that. We had lots of interesting adventures in Barmaid, but yes, no cake.
Hello. Hi there. Yeah. I could see the map. There's a lot of places that you guys traveled on the west side. So after the book, what's next for you two?
So lots not done, right?
Yeah,
Eastern India, Northeast.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's going to be the third book.
Okay.
So all the states along the eastern coastline, barring Tamil Nadu, are left. The Northeast is left.
So
and Jammu and Kashmir is left.
So do you plan to... travel all those places that you haven't traveled to in a different perspective.
Yes, exactly.
Different modes of transport.
Yeah, exactly.
So what are those? Or
so one is we thought that for Eastern India we would do trains because you know there's like a dense network of trains and Gorakhpur is the hub of Eastern railways, And we thought that one of the other sort of experiments, it would be interesting to not do this breakneck journey, to pick a few places and stay longer in one place so that it doesn't become the same experiment. We change the variables a bit.
See, Eastern India also, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. And what about the Seven Sisters? How would you travel? Because the traveling there is very different and very rugged. And
that's right.
You would get rare occasion that you would get a hitchhiking car for a hitchhiking.
Yeah. So fortunately, after this book, we've had lots of people, lots of locals volunteer that, you know, when you come to the Northeast, to other parts also, we would love to help you and be involved, which is why we thought that we'll do it this way, that we'd stay in one place and do a deeper analysis of each place that we are in, and with far greater local involvement, I would say.
One more suggestion, just do trekking when you are in Northeast.
We'll definitely do that. We've done trekking on this journey too. It's not only buses, we've also walked distances, climbed hills. We climbed Girnar in Junagar, which has 9,999 steps. So we did that too. The other thing is that we are more familiar with Eastern India because our roots are from there.
Yeah.
So that's also the reason why we chose to do these other parts of India.
We have a question here. Hi. Actually, I have a series of questions. First being, why heat and dust?
Yeah, good question. So, see, heat and dust is the cliche associated with India, right? As late as Elizabeth Gilbert in her book, Eat, Pray and Love, I don't know if you guys have read it.
Yeah.
Yeah? She says that outside the ashram, it was all heat and dust. You know, so we wanted to challenge that, you know.
Ruth Prawal Jawala's eponymous book, right? Heat and Dust, which is very famous, was made into a Merchant Ivory film.
So that's why this is the Heat and Dust project. We critique sort of the Gora version of India, and we try to embrace the heat and dust, let's say.
My second question to you, both of you, is I'm just giving an example. I've been to Himachal for a month, last month, and there were so many experiences, and I actually thought of putting that on a piece of paper, and I was like, oh my God, where should I start from? Where should I end? So how did you guys go about it? Because you have had a really long journey, as I can see. And how did you actually put it in across? And again, quoting you, what you said, that while you were in the journey, you had a different kind of mindset, right? And when you come back, you have a different kind of mindset. You're not in that zone. You're not in that experience.
That's right. Yeah, yeah.
So how did you go back to that kind of area or that kind of mindset?
So one thing that, you know, I found very useful is the writer Zach Oye. You know, he was in an interview, he said that a very useful tool when you're writing about travel is that after a few days you forget some things, and that's very good, because if you try to recall in great detail every single trial and tribulation you had, it would make for very dull reading. You know, it seems a lot of the urgency becomes very repetitive if you go on and on with it, which is why, you know, we found the writing of the book to be a greater challenge, that we had to convey the essence yet distill. So hopefully, you know, you can say when you read the book if that's worked or not.
If you've managed to do it.
Yeah. Oh, surely I would love to read the book. And the last question, as you said about the essence, about the experiences. So I would like to know, I mean, as you said that, you know, there were some experiences that came up and you just forgot some, because you can't remember, exactly, you can't remember all of those. So which were your best experiences in this whole journey? And I would even like to know the ones where you could actually thought as if you could learn a lot from this kind of experience.
Well, there were also several troubling experiences too, which we've again documented. There were a lot of like incredible moments. Let's go back to the sand dune in Barmer, where our autowala invited us home for dinner.
Yeah, apparently we learned how to trust the kindness of strangers, you know, over there.
Yeah.
So that was one thing. At least I did. She always believed in that.
So we. So going to his house for dinner, spending time with his family, again sharing in their stories, that was quite amazing. And it's very difficult to to say what was absolutely amazing for both of us was, you know, that moment in the bus when the bus took off and hit the highway, you know, went through the town and hit the highway. That feeling of being alive, even now that persists, you know. There are like months, everybody has to sort of get back to their dull jobs.
Yeah,
and lives.
There are a lot of small places that we've been to which are not there on the map, right? So, I mean, spending time there in itself is an experience. It shows you how, and people outside of the big cities, they are far more curious about things in general than people with the been there, done that attitude that you get in the, you know, in the center. So the so-called periphery has far more, has a much higher level of curiosity. And they have a lot to share. They have a lot to share. They want to learn from you, but they also want to tell you things.
Teach you. So I think, yeah, I think it was mix of them. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, hi. So I wanted to know, did there come a point of time when you guys got saturated, like literally saturated, and wanted to leave this whole journey?
I would like to know about that.
I think there were quite a few of those. But the good thing is that
And what she's too polite to ask, I think, is that if we, you know, wanted to kill each other.
Yeah, so I actually wanted to go that way.
I really don't know how we did not manage to do that, but you're right about that. There were quite a few instances of that.
There was also one very big fight in Jaisalmer, which is documented in the book with great honesty.
So this book is sometimes also billed as the ultimate relationship test, apparently. That if you can tolerate each other on a budget like this, you know,
then maybe you can tolerate each other through life.
But you know, here I'll just say one thing. The fact that there were two of us makes a difference. When one person is flagging, the other person shows that person up, you know. That makes a lot of difference.
But I know what you're saying, that even, you know, there are points. So there is one bit when we are in Mathura and we say that, you know, we're no longer in that travel mode. You know, it's just, there are these bare days. There are these empty days when you don't do anything. You don't observe anything. You don't take notes. You don't have intelligent conversations with people that will add to you. You just let it all go.
There are a lot of things that well up that you have to deal with. Things between the two of you, things inside yourself, things elsewhere. It's something. I mean,
not to mention the anxiety about money.
So there have been a total of 167 or 8 days of journeying like this. So of course in 3 phases, but this phase in particular, the one that goes from
Delhi to Kanyakumari,
in the middle of summer, that can be a bit tedious at times.
Thank you so much.
Maybe we have time for one last question from anyone. Okay.
Hi. That was fascinating. So I just wanted to know, were there days in, you know, where you actually were so tired, that's a continuation of Vaishali's question, that you said, okay, let's just chuck the 500 day and thing, and can we just get back momentarily to our lives?
Unfortunately, this alchemist was far too strict. Uh-huh. But there is one day, only one day in the long journey in we were in Kerala. This is going to be in the next book. When I was desperate for a hot bath, like a real hot bath, not a bucket, you know, because the buckets, by the time they get to you, the water becomes cold. So I told him that I need a hot bath and we are going to find a hotel with a geyser. So for that one day we went in, I think it was in Kannur. Kannur, we went to a hotel which was sort of, you know.
Well, when you're on a budget like this, all that you care about is clean sheets, that's all. Because you can cancel. There's no question of having a TV in the room or anything, you know.
Yeah. So that was the only day so we went to that. We were leaving the same night. So they gave us the room for a few hours. That was like very shady, but that bathroom had a geyser.
Yeah, we've seen many of those ghante ke hisab se rooms, by the way, on this journey.
Yeah, and of course, they used to ask us that, you know, are you friends? Like in every hotel reception. And we would say very sort of sheepishly, no, we are married. And they would be terribly disappointed. They were much rather that we were friends.
Yeah, maybe we would have got a discount otherwise. You know?
Yes.
Right, this is not a question, but something that some of us experience when we travel through UP you know, as students. And we traveled on a, again, I mean, we didn't have a per day restriction, but we were poor. We still are. Actually, architects are perpetually poor.
Well, so are writers, I suppose. So there's that whole community.
So we traveled across UP and what is now Uttarakhand for about 15 or 16 days. And I remember we, excluding the train ticket from Bombay to Lucknow, and back, we did about 16 days in 4,000 rupees, and which included Lucknowi sari for mummy. And
when was this?
This was long, I mean, this was 95, 96.
Yeah, it was totally possible at that
yeah,
time.
And of course, it included drinks every day. So, so now, one of the tricks that we did was that we always traveled in the night so that we saved on accommodation. And so that just helped us.
Yeah.
So if you traveled, you could sort of, that's what made some other things possible.
Yeah, yeah.
That
we
was
did
our
that
trick too, by the way, for many places.
Yeah.
But we had to stay at least for a while in some place. Mm-hmm. Two
because
or three
in that
days.
Sort of, yeah, sleeping at night then, you know, became important because after so many hours in the buses, after a while, you know, I could no longer sleep in the bus. Mm-hmm. So... But that's a really useful trick.
Yeah, that is a trick that you will have to use.
And unfortunately, such was the strict accounting of somebody. I was not allowed to bring any gifts for anybody, including myself.
Even postcards
that I bought were strictly accounted for.
Listen, I was trained in alchemy, not in accountancy.
Well, yes,
okay.
Yes. Anyway, so. That's an important question, and we always like to answer this. It did help that we were traveling together rather than, you know, if I were alone, it would have been a different experience. But we did not feel unsafe. We, you know, what would happen, which we mapped later on, is once we went to a new place and we would always reach at night because we would budget to reach in the evening and the buses would naturally take far longer. At night, a new place, everybody seemed very shady. The rooms, the hotels seemed super shady. And everybody was like a possible criminal, rapist. Yeah.
But the good thing is, given the hour at which you've alighted from the bus, you have to accept, you know, admit the possibility that they think you too are shady, you know.
You too could be a danger.
And that
yeah.
sort of, you know, gives you a certain kind of
leverage.
Protection of its own, you know. That you might be a tough customer too. Of course, having two people traveling was also, you know, takes care of that problem to an extent.
But, you know, but there's this story that we always share, you know, for young women traveling alone. We met a lot of young women traveling from different parts of the world, and they were traveling in India alone. And we also heard about this sociologist who did this giant experiment in India where she went with truckers from one place to another, only trucks at night.
She just hitchhiked with truckers across India. This is something we got to learn later, much later after this undertaking. She did a thesis. She's written a thesis on...
It was for her PhD thesis. So that also tells you something about safety, right? That it is done. It can be done. You can travel safe. Of course, there are incidents which are awful.
We've documented such an unsavory incident in this book. There are more incidents in the... There will be more incidents in the next book. The one which is called Man Woman Road that comes after.
That's going
this.
To be the sequel to this.
Okay. Hi. This side. Left. Prior to this journey, I mean, each one of us individually, we have some impressions of various states, places, cross sections of cultures, and everything. So after this journey, I'm sure you must have had a reality check on people. You said, you know, you meet a lot of people and all that. So. As a country, I mean, what we are taught about our country in our school and, you know, what the social media and the media puts it out to be. Is there a change of how you are looking at the country now in terms of how the people are, how the places are? I mean, how has that, is that impression changed or it's still the same or there are, you know, we don't see the finer details of our country?
Right. See, the thing about... school, you know, especially school learning, is that everything is made a bit black and white in nature. What we want to emphasize is that what we learned from our travels is that every part of India is very complex. All the people we met, they have the sort of the a complex sophistication. There is no simple villager, you know, that is a pretty
does not exist.
Patronizing, nonsensical notion. So I think that, of course, is an important takeaway.
But the simple villager, politically astute as he is, does not engage in the sort of polarized debate that you find on social media nowadays. His understanding of politics is far more nuanced, and he probably does not have the luxury of having a very sharp opinion on every matter either. Right? So it's like this. They'll see the... And from that you can understand why democracy works in India, you know. They see a fine balance. They could tilt towards either side, depending on the ground level realities and the wave as it is.
And their sort of radar is as good as it comes.
You must not forget that I have to say this, because a lot of people on social media, they don't even live in India anymore. Right, they are the so-called NRI or PIO category. These are people who are not invested here. They are not invested here. They have left this place for good. But the internet allows them to share their opinion on it nonetheless.
And many of it from those old classroom black and white notions. So I think what this journey really did
is they didn't even buy our book much, by the way. So.
That, you know, that the complexity that... that is the hallmark of a civilization in motion, is definitely, it's happening. Change is happening, and it's great to see. The curiosity of young people.
We don't profess to have shared an objective truth in any way, right?
So of course it's filtered.
It's how we saw India at that point of time as it was to us.
And like you said, that, you know, some of the comparative things, of course, throw up interesting, you know. So I would have to say that probably Himachal Pradesh is the politest state of all that we traveled in. Do you agree? Well, but that's just for fun.
No, I think, you know? even contrary to what people think, even Madhya Pradesh is very polite. Yeah. Madhya Pradesh people don't hassle around over there.
You know,
the
you
way they do in
the
Gangetic Belt, or they do down south, they don't do it there at all.
So, but these, of course, are, you know, sort of bald assertions. We've tried to keep the nuance in the narrative.
Hello, yeah. As a writer, are you trying to compete with other writers?
I hope we are not. You know, I really hope we are not.
Well,
because competing with other writers, as in what? Are you talking about the 99th percentile? Or are you talking about something beyond that?
You don't know
who we are competing with. We are competing for books, you know, shelf space with a lot of people, I agree.
So automatically then you are competing. And, you know, sometimes we joke that when we go to our publisher's office, it's a bit like, you know, it's a bit like school report card day, you know, where teachers, you know, tell you, you've not done that well, but your teacher is going to tell you.
The first thing the publisher will say, the publisher, and I'm not talking about the head of sales at your publishing house, no, XYZ's book, it sold 20,000 copies in the first week
print,
itself.
Yeah, and we are reprinting.
So it was pre-ordered, you know, in the thousands on Amazon. So you can't imagine the kind of pressure that you have to undergo nowadays as a writer. There are chaps who waltz into these publishing houses, make presentations and call their book a product, right? And before writing the book, they actually make a PowerPoint presentation about what they're going to do for the book
after the
book comes out, right?
So, you know, when you are a writer, happy to be poor like us, then you don't compete with other writers. You compete with yourself. You're always anxious. So now we are already, you know, you're at sea again. You finish one book and then you know the next, it's going to be as difficult all over again. So if you can, you know... satisfy yourself for 5 minutes, it only lasts for 5 minutes. That's why you have to write another book.
Right, I think we'll have to pull the plugs. Oh, there's one more question.
How long was this journey?
How
many days?
How many days was this journey? Yeah.
167 days in all, over three phases. The main phase was a 90-day continuous journey from Delhi to down south. That was the 90s.
100 days.
Well, yeah, 10 yeah. more days you could add because of the preparation time and all yeah. that.
To yes. Kanyakumari, right, we ended it in Chennai. That was a 100-day journey. And the first book, that documents another 2 months.
That's a 27-day journey, the first part of the project. And then there is another leg of journeys in the hills, in the Himalayas.
And of course, there's the future to look forward to, where I hope maybe it'll be for a year.
For a year?
Yeah, okay. Eastern India. Okay.
All right. Devapriya and Saurav, absolute pleasure. Thank you so much. Put your hands together for the Heat and Dust project.
Thank you, Jinu, for you. Having us here.
Pleasure.
We are very grateful to you.
The Heat and Dust project is available. It's been published by Hatchet.
Published by Harper Collins.
Harper Collins, okay. So you know where to go and buy the book so that they can travel more and get to write more.
And she wants to travel for a year, remember that.
All right.
Pleasure being here. Thank you for having us over. And you guys have been wonderful.
You're a wonderful audience.